My name is Amit Nerurkar. I work in artist management and album campaign management, which is something I have coined. It's not something that exists otherwise. I've been fortunate to work with artists that stand for these things. They're multifaceted. They've always been independent. So they've been independent of thought. And when I say that, they've had the chances to actually take the risks that they wanted to take in their lives. Invariably, and this is something which I feel is even more relevant now in 2019, over the years, they've managed to develop a very dedicated fan base where they allow people to actually take risks artistically and even otherwise. And this to me is probably the most important thing for an artist is to actually allow yourself to grow. There might be something that you might want when you're 21, which may change when you're 25. And I think you have to think it through, take those risks. It's completely fine to pivot. And I think you as an artist should be allowed that space. That's something that really annoys me to a large extent is when people tell you the music that you should make rather than the music that you want to make. The biggest thing for me is always think for yourself. I'm not saying be selfish as much as one really key point to remember is that it's your music. You'll have labels that'll come and go. You'll have managers that'll come and go. There will be people who'll help you always facilitate things. But eventually, it's your vision and the person who you're with ideally helps you achieve that vision. And which is why, as I say, you have to trust your instincts because it's a process, it's a journey. You have to grow. And eventually, that last point is massive. Trying to have fun doing this, it really is. You have to have fun doing it. I think as a career choice, it's not something which you know for a fact that there's a way of you getting promoted to a job, there's health insurance, you don't have any of that. So at the very least, if you are going to take these risks, then you should have fun doing it. There's no such thing as a sellout. It's all very subjective. So if you decide that you want to you want to be on the cereal box and that's your thing and you want to take that check, take it, but be clear that what comes with it. If you don't and you're like, I don't want my song licensed to a certain brand because I don't align myself with that brand, fine, but you're not going to get that check. But as long as you are cool with what you're doing, I feel like there's no such thing as a sellout. Try and be as authentic as you can and then the rest will sort of follow. You have your form of communication, you have your way of doing things, which is authenticity. Now we come to access. And this to me is massive in 2019 as well. Your fans are all over the world, are all over the place. Everyone's everywhere. You want to make sure that you get your music heard wherever it is possible to be played. Be platform agnostic. Try and get your music everywhere you can. Don't try windowing, which is a big thing that people do, which is if certain services give you a chunk of money, they're like, oh, well, we want exclusivity. Try your best not to do that because it just doesn't help at all. You know, not everyone's Jay-Z. So for instance, you know, even if it's an audio track that you have, make sure you get it up on YouTube because there's a whole community of people globally that are sitting out there. And that to me is very important that you have to recognize that it's not only about the US anymore, where you live. It's about the whole world. I have to quote sort of my mentor slash elder bro, Amici, who manages Run the Jewels. But he always used to say this, and I kind of agree with it, and I kind of use it now in my life, which is you should play chess, not checkers. And the reason I say that is because you need to have a plan. One of the biggest things I have to tell you is that while this looks incredibly equal between pre-release and post, as I've written below, it's clearly not fit to scale. So in other words, you can have a far shorter pre-release campaign, much longer release campaign, and a shorter post-release campaign. There's no set formula for how you should go about doing it. I think each artist is different. I think it's highly important to try and get some kind of a home base, something which you can count on that, look, if nothing happens, they got my back. I have a gig there. They're going to buy my t-shirt, they're going to buy my CD, whatever it is. Visual content is incredibly important in this day and age because it travels online, it can be seen across the world. It's not so much only about your live show. The goldmine, which is the playlist, something which I can sit right next to you guys and say, I wish I would get playlisted, but it's incredibly hard, honestly. I mean, I could have artists that that stream millions of records and they really don't get the playlist that they deserve or what I think deserve. But the big thing for me is you cannot have it be the cornerstone of a campaign. What I will say is that when that happens, have a plan to make sure that you can actually exploit it. Make sure you advertise to people who listen to other artists on that playlist. Make sure if you haven't got a video, that's when you actually make a video for that song. There's a few things you can do, but what you do is you kind of do it anyway, and then you give Spotify enough of a reason to add you to a playlist. And that's why I'm saying, like, an album is still important. I feel like it represents a body of work from an artist. There's a thought in your head. You need something to, like, cut through the noise. Now you actually have the option of getting data, and it's not only from one place, it's from all those places. You've got Spotify for your artists, which out of all the DSPs, I gotta say, out of all the digital retailers, is easily the best. There's not many others who share data with you. But you've got, you know, you've got your Twitter data, you've got Facebook, you've got Instagram, YouTube, and there's all this data, and it's incredibly daunting to look at. Like, understanding who and where your fans are is probably one of the most important things that you could do. But what's cool is when you actually preempt that and you go to places, as I said, how you target your fans, you can focus your spend, you can do live shows, you can customize merch. So it's really about what you can do with that data. And you can also probably go after similar artists and you can look at trying to reach out to them to try and get gigs with them. That helps a lot as well. Embrace Your Fans. This was a classic record which Run the Jewels did, which they remixed the entire Run the Jewels 2 with Cat Sounds. So reward your fans. This is a big one. Dess is really known for her lyrics. She hand-wrote lyrics. She sold them as merch because she had actually run out of merch, but it was a brilliant idea. Her fans love her lyrics. Wiki, he has this classic Puerto Rican-Irish heritage, and he talks about it in most of his rap songs. So he made a nice pin with his flag on it. Freddie and Madlib. Madlib's fans are diehard vinyl heads. Gave them exclusive 12-inch test presses with bonus beats. If you like what I say, follow these guys. They're my artists. You don't need to follow me. I'm faceless. Do ask me if you have any questions. Anyone?
Hi, my name's Deidre. I liked all the authentic strategy that you talked about for each of your artists. Sure. I was curious if you had any examples on following up on something specific like a sync placement and how, if you've had any experience taking advantage of something like that in a way that does feel authentic.
We had, as I was mentioning earlier, the DJ Shadow, Run the Jewels. Now, Run the Jewels was still on the up. Shadow is quite a legend. We had that collaborative song. It was going to premiere in the end credits of Silicon Valley on that weekend. Coincidentally, Run the Jewels were playing Coachella that weekend on the main stage, but early on. So what I did was we got Shadow out there to come out and play that song, which was on Sunday, and Sunday night was Silicon Valley. So all the press the next day were talking about how Shadow came out, did the new song with Run the Jewels, and then the Silicon Valley thing went live. I know it's at a different level, but what I'm trying to say here is that if you have three things that are happening, right? Like, let's say you have a video, you may have a remix, you may have a really interesting, compelling piece of a documentary of sorts. Let's say about like a making of or whatever you want to call it. And you had plans to like drag out your assets, make them work for the next 2 months. Don't, just make them all work in the span of 10 days while this big thing is happening, because that's when everyone is paying attention to you. But I think what I've learned is when you get something, you try and bunch it together and it'll lead to something else, and you'll probably think of a better idea for that thing that you wanted to do later on down the road. Thank you. Thanks for coming.